and welcome to Ask a Paleontologist. I'm Dr. Scott Persons, and this episode's question is, why do I think there's more than one species of Tyrannosaurus? Which I do, but that's a very controversial opinion. To begin, let's make sure we're clear on what I mean when I say a Tyrannosaurus species. When we talk about different dinosaurs, we commonly use names like Triceratops, Brontosaurus, Velociraptor, or Tyrannosaurus, and those are not the names of particular species. They are genus names. A genus is a higher level of biological classification. It's one step up above species. Within a genus, there can be many different but very closely related species. For example, today, lions, tigers, leopards, and jaguars all belong to the same genus of big cat, Panthera. But they are all different species. Lions are Panthera leo, tigers are Panthera tigris, and so on. So when I say I think there's more than one species of Tyrannosaurus, I'm not really saying anything about the name Tyrannosaurus. Instead, it's all about the species name Rex. Ever since Tyrannosaurus Rex was named back in 1905, paleontologists have been slowly discovering and excavating Tyrannosaurus fossils from the late Cretaceous rocks of the Hell Creek, the Lance, and the Frenchman formations, and across Western North America. And those fossils have all been referred to the one species, Tyrannosaurus rex. In fact, Tyrannosaurus is one of the most well-documented and highly studied of all dinosaurs. Now, more than 30 good skeletons have been found. So why now should I think there's really more than one species in the genus? Precisely because so many skeletons have been found across such a great geographic range and across so much time. Stratigraphic data, that is, information on different sequential rock layers, indicates that Tyrannosaurus fossils have been found across a range of over 1.5 million years. That's a lot of time for one species of dinosaur to have remained unchanged. It is not what I would predict based on our understanding of the evolution of modern birds and big mammals. For instance, genetic studies have shown that the lineages within the genus Panthera that eventually evolved into today's lions and tigers split off within the last 1 to 1.5 million years. As an endothermic, or warm-blooded, top predator, Tyrannosaurus must have been limited to small population sizes. After all, it would take a lot of food resources to feed even a small Tyrannosaurus population. And we know from microscopic studies of Tyrannosaurus bone growth that Tyrannosaurus was a fast-growing animal that reached its colossal adult size within around 20 years. Now, no Tyrannosaurus nests have been found so far, so we don't know for sure. But if other theropod dinosaurs like Allosaurus are any indicator, Tyrannosaurus also probably had large clutch sizes, and it may have laid between 10 to 20 eggs in every nest. Well, small population sizes, rapid growth, and large clutch sizes are all traits that can speed up the evolutionary process and lead to rapid speciation. Of course, it's also possible that there was more than one species of Tyrannosaurus around at the exact same time, even in the exact same habitat. Just as today, lions and leopards can be found in the same habitat, or grizzly bears and black bears, both members of the same genus, Ursus, can live together today in parts of Western North America. At first, it might seem odd to think there could be two big carnivorous dinosaur species living side by side. But we know that earlier in the late Cretaceous of North America, two totally different genera of tyrannosaurids, Gorgosaurus and Despletosaurus, were cohabitants. Much further back into Jurassic times, North America was simultaneously host to allosaurs, megalosaurs, and ceratosaurs. And a great many well-sampled dinosaur ecosystems, like the Baja Rio Formation of Egypt or the Huincul Formation of Argentina, tell a similar story. Lots of huge carnivorous dinosaurs could and did live alongside one another. Finally, there's the fact that the evolution from one species to another has been documented for another large dinosaur across the exact same rock layers as Tyrannosaurus. In a 2014 study, Scanella et al. Documented that two previously controversial species of Triceratops, Triceratops proboscis and Triceratops horridus, were different species separated by time. The species Triceratops horridus, like this one, has a nose horn that's far less prominent and is found only at stratigraphically lower positions, whereas Triceratops proboscis has got a much more prominent pointy nose horn and brow horns with a much stronger forward curve to them, and it's only found at stratigraphically high positions. Okay, but if there were multiple species of Tyrannosaurus, why haven't we detected them? After all, shouldn't different species have very differently looking skeletons? Well, no. At least, not necessarily. Today, it's very hard to tell the skeleton of a large lion apart from the skeleton of a small tiger, and most of the big cat's bones simply are not distinguishable. Birds, which of course are modern dinosaurs, are an even more extreme case. You simply cannot distinguish many songbirds based only on their skeletons. In fact, a few bird species cannot be distinguished from dead specimens with all the flesh and feathers fully intact. Instead, you need to hear them sing. Similarly, it took genetic studies to demonstrate that there are actually two modern species of African elephants, bush elephants and forest elephants, and we sure can't look at the genetics of a Tyrannosaurus. And those two species of Triceratops? Their skeletons show no demonstrable differences from the neck down. But at least the skulls are clearly different, right? Well, yes, but be careful, because that's only true for specific parts of the skull, the jaws, and even the complex combination of bones that forms the brain case are not used to tell the species apart. And this is actually true for a lot of dinosaurs, even at the genus level. Many duck-billed dinosaurs and ceratopsians are notoriously impossible to identify to a particular genus, even from otherwise beautiful and fully articulated but headless skeletons. And there again, it's really just the horns and the crests that are truly diagnostic. Why? Because horns, although they're also absolutely useful for protection from predators, are, like crests, used as sexual display structures. They're used in courtship. They're waved and paraded about and brandished against romantic rivals. So they're subject to sexual selection. And that causes them to constantly evolve rapidly, even as the rest of the skeleton remains suitably adapted to an otherwise unchanging environment. If a dinosaur like Styracosaurus didn't have its unusual pattern of big frill spikes to distinguish it from a closely related genus, Centrosaurus, we would have had no way of knowing they actually do belong to different genera. If Triceratops, Proboscis, and Horridus did not have big horns that were subject to evolution through sexual selection, they never would have been recognized as different species, even though in life there would have undoubtedly been a lot of other differences between them. They must have been at least slightly different colors with different patterns, and they may well have had different calls. Tyrannosaurs do not have big horns or big crests. So, if there were multiple species of Tyrannosaurus, it is not reasonable to expect the skulls be easy to tell apart. There you go. Those are the main reasons why I think there was more than one species of Tyrannosaurus. Being around for such a long time, living across such a wide area, and being a warm-blooded top predator, I think it would actually be really, really strange if it turns out there was actually only ever one species within the genus Tyrannosaurus. And given the comparatively large number of Tyrannosaurus skeletons that have now been discovered, I think it's also very improbable that all of those skeletons happen to have belonged to just one particular species. Now, having said that, it is one thing to argue there probably was more than one species of Tyrannosaurus, but it is quite another to try and figure out what those species were. That brings me to this paper, which was just published in the peer-reviewed scientific journal Evolutionary Biology. The paper shares the results of a study led by paleontologist Greg Paul, along with myself and my friend Jay Van Roll. Our study considered two curious differences that other paleontologists previously noted between Tyrannosaurus skeletons. One was the overall degree of skeletal robusticity, meaning how thick and burly the bones are. Some Tyrannosaurus specimens, like Sue or Scotty, have proportionately stout bones, and other specimens have noticeably more gracile, meaning skinny and slender, bones. This difference in bone burliness has long been the subject of debate. Maybe instead, the difference is just variation within the same species. After all, plenty of other Homo sapiens are a lot burlier than me with noticeably thicker skeletons. But we are still the same species. Just how much variability should there be within one species of big theropod dinosaur? To try and determine that, we needed a large sample of another big carnivorous dinosaur. Ideally, a sample from only one particular point in time and from one particular spot, so that we could be relatively confident the sample really was just of the one species. For that, we turned to the Cleveland Lloyd Dinosaur Quarry in Utah. This is an astounding site that contains more than 13 full-grown skeletons of Allosaurus fragilis. We charted the variability relative to body size of the femora of the Cleveland Lloyd Allosaurus fragilis sample. The femur is the upper leg bone. And then we compared that variability to the variability and the robusticity of femora from a sample of Tyrannosaurus. And the variability in Tyrannosaurus was greater than what we found in the Allosaurus. What's more, it was found to be significantly greater using a statistical test. Sometimes new dinosaurs are not discovered with shovels and pickaxes. Sometimes you find them with math. Next is a trait that was first recognized by paleontologist Dr. Robert Bakker, and it's well documented in the literature by Peter Larson. Some Tyrannosaurus specimens have got two sets of small front teeth with a more chisel-like shape in their lower jaw. Now, teeth like this are not unique to Tyrannosaurus. Other Tyrannosaurs have them too, but some Tyrannosaurus specimens only have one set of the tiny chisel-like front teeth. Dr. Bakker argued that this difference in front tooth form might be diagnostic of different species. Then, our study did something new. Based on how useful stratigraphy proved to be in identifying different Triceratops species, we accumulated stratigraphic data for as many Tyrannosaurus specimens as we could. And that was it. Three lines of evidence: skeletal robusticity, presence or absence of two chisel-like tooth sets, and stratigraphic position. Looking at all three, a few patterns did emerge. First, no gracile skeletons are known from older, lower rock layers, and neither were specimens with just one chisel-like tooth set. All the gracile specimens were from higher, younger stratigraphic positions in time, and all of them have only a single set of chisel-like front teeth. In fact, there is a statistically significant correlation between being gracile and having just one chisel tooth set. But graciles were not totally alone in this trait. Some robust Tyrannosaurus also have only one chisel tooth set. What's going on? Well, our paper argues that the burlier and double chisel tooth form found in the older layers was one species that gave rise to two others, both of which reduced the number of front chisel tooth sets down to just one, with one new species staying burly and the other becoming slenderer. At least, that's our hypothesis. Remember, in paleontology, all species are hypotheses. Modern animal biology defines a species as a reproductively isolated group of organisms that will reproduce to yield fertile offspring only amongst themselves. As a paleontologist, I cannot stick two fossils together and see if they will reproduce.
When the moon hits your eye like a big pizza pie, that's amore. When the world seems to shine like you've had too much wine, that's...
To go along with our species hypotheses, we proposed some new names. Of course, the name Tyrannosaurus rex sticks around. The original specimen used to define T-Rex, what we call a holotype or type specimen, is of the burly one chisel tooth set stratigraphically high variety. The name Tyrannosaurus rex means tyrant lizard king. So, for the more gracile species that lived at the same time, the sort of co-ruler of the uppermost Late Cretaceous, we awarded it the title Tyrannosaurus regina, the tyrant lizard queen. And the robust, double chisel tooth set species from lower down, which may well have been the ancestor of the other two, we named that Tyrannosaurus imperator, the tyrant lizard emperor. Now, does our study provide overwhelming and undeniable evidence for these new species? No. Don't get me wrong. We offer a real scientific case for the new species, but I want to make it very clear that these new species within Tyrannosaurus are highly contentious. Why? Well, the great science communicator Carl Sagan famously said, "Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence." Our evidence is not extraordinary. The mathematical support for the relationships between the different traits is not always strong, and even good statistics can be wrong if an improbable thing happens to be true. We're limited by the incompleteness of many of the specimens in the study and by a lack of data for many others. And there are alternatives out there that might explain the pattern that we are seeing. But is the claim really extraordinary? On the one hand, sure, T-Rex is certainly the most famous of all dinosaurs. In fact, it is possibly the most famous species name of all time. After all, Don't more kids know the name Tyrannosaurus rex than their own species, Homo sapiens? To suggest splitting the most famous dinosaur into three is arguably an extraordinary thing. On the other hand, if you're like me and fully expect any one long-living genus of dinosaur to contain multiple hard-to-detect species, then the interpretations in our study are not at all extraordinary. They're exactly in line with what you would predict. Where do we go from here? Well, first, let me say that it's not appropriate for the Chicago Field Museum or the Smithsonian to scrub the name T-Rex from all of their merchandise. And I don't expect our three new species to send dinosaur museums everywhere into a frenzy relabeling their skeletons. I sincerely think it's too early for that. Our hypothesis is too fresh. It needs further testing. I do think we need to consider the implications of multiple species within Tyrannosaurus and what the next steps towards testing the hypothesis ought to be. Because like any good scientific hypothesis, our species can be tested via their assumed predictive power. I think our paper does a really good job of laying out how. If we're right, future Tyrannosaurus skeletal discoveries should adhere to our groups. We should not go on to find a double chiseled tooth Tyrannosaurus at a stratigraphically high point. Nor should we find skinny boned or single chiseled tooth set Tyrannosaurus low down, or skinny boned Tyrannosaurus with double sets of chisel-like teeth anywhere. If we do, then you can scratch the corresponding species. But if future discoveries do adhere, that will be increasingly strong evidence. Next, we might also look for other differences between Tyrannosaurus specimens and see if they line up with the proposed species. What might those other differences be? Well, one place to start looking is the arm. Tyrannosaurus really does have small arms relative to its body size. And the arms of Tyrannosaurus are smaller for its size than in other older Tyrannosauroids. So maybe arm length also changed throughout the evolution within Tyrannosaurus. Another spot that I'm suspicious of is the head. While it's true Tyrannosaurus does not have large horns or crests, it does have some small ones. Have a look right above the orbit. That lump of bone is called the postorbital boss. And have a look running down the snout. That wrinkly bone there forms a low-lying crest. And just like larger horns and crests, these smaller cranial ornamentations were probably associated with sexual display. And so I'm suspicious that they would have been prone to changing between the species as well. Lastly, I know that some of you might be a little bummed at the possibility that the Tyrannosaurus skeleton in your local museum may not actually be Tyrannosaurus rex. But take heart. If it's true there's more than one species, then I think that makes every Tyrannosaurus that much cooler. To think that there was only ever one species of Tyrannosaurus is to think that Tyrannosaurus was stagnant, that it was just hanging on as part of an oddly big theropod impoverished ecosystem. Instead, I suspect Tyrannosaurus was dynamic. It was a genus that was evolving, diversifying, and keeping pace with the evolution of its herbivorous rival, Triceratops, right up until the very end. Thanks for watching.